The Lord be with you. I want to welcome everyone here for the Sunday of the baptism of our Lord. This is actually the first Sunday of Epiphany. I know many of you know that Epiphany was on Thursday, and so we're changing gears to some degree, but we're not. Epiphany is still part of what people who talk about these things call the Christmas cycle, that instead now of Jesus just appearing to shepherds and the wise men, we remember that Jesus is for all people and that he comes to all people. So you might say there's a mission focus in the season of Epiphany. And you'll hear a bit of that today as we're talking about the baptism of our Lord. Our opening hymn for today is Songs of Thankfulness and Praise. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness. Therefore you are feared. Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise. Let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Father in heaven, at the baptism of Jesus in the Jordan River, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Make all who are baptized in his name faithful in their calling as your children and inheritors with him of everlasting life. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Thank you.
The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 1 through 7. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in exchange for you. Because you are precious in my eyes and honored, and I love you, I give men in return for you, peoples in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is from Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 11. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin still live in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too may walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we have died with Christ, we believe that we also will live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin, once for all, but the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Speak together with me these words from Psalm 29. Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The glory of God thunders. The Lord over many waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon to skip like a calf, and Syrian like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord flashes forth flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord makes the deer give birth and strips the forest bare, and in his temple all cry glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as king forever. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. Please rise. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the third chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. As the people were in expectation and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Christ, John answered them all, saying, I baptize you with water, but he who is mightier than I is coming, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. So with many other exhortations he preached good news to the people, but Herod the Tetrarch, who had been reproved by him for Herodias, his brother's wife, and for all the evil things that Herod had done, added this to them all, that he locked up John in prison. Now when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heavens were opened, and the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form, like a dove, and a voice came from heaven, You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated, and I ask for the children to come forward. Thank you. Okay, I guess I'm looking out, and I guess, hi there, how are you doing? So, I got a question for you. This is a time when you still are thinking about some of the gifts you got for Christmas, right? Well, you know what? There is a gift that you were given a long time ago. Well, a long time as far as you're concerned. Maybe not as far as your mom and dad. But you know what? A gift you were given, which is actually a best gift of all. Do you know what that gift was? That was when you were baptized. That's kind of exciting, isn't it? You've seen baptisms. You were here when your brother was baptized, right? So what happens in a baptism? Is there water? And does the pastor get to hold the baby? And he pours water on the baby? So is that all that's going on? Or is there something else that's happening? There's something else happening, isn't there? That God promises that he who is baptized will be saved. That's an important thing. And we hear in today's epistle reading that everything that Jesus did for you was given you in your baptism. That's kind of exciting. What did Jesus do for you? Do you know what did he do for you? Did he die on the cross to forgive you of all your sins? Does he forgive you for those times when you've done bad things? Does he help you in those times when you need help? Does he give you the promise that one of these days you're going to live forever and ever with him in heaven? Boy, that's kind of exciting, isn't it? That's a piece of good news. Well, today we're talking about Jesus' baptism, and we're also talking about our baptisms. You know, I was baptized when I was 12 years old. I won't go into why that happened. I was actually pretty grown by then, and I remember that vividly. But you know what? Even if you were baptized when you were real young, you know that you were baptized, right? Do your mom and dad, do you have their baptismal certificate? Okay. Have you shown it to them? You know what? That's proof that you were baptized. I know you were baptized. And then there are people who witness the fact that you were baptized. That's also exciting. And you know that the fact is that God has given you all of those gifts, and that's a wonderful thing. So today we can celebrate the fact that you have the greatest Christmas gift of all, and his name is Jesus. Very good. And you know what? All of you have the greatest Christmas gift of all, and his name is Jesus. Okay, you can go ahead and go back to your seat, and we're going to sing the sermon hymn. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I've always been glad that for most of the problems that come along in our life, there are potentially a number of different ways that they might be solved. Now, it's true, some of the solutions may be better, some worse. Some may be more practical, some more impractical. But ultimately, we have to pick one, or maybe two, if the first one doesn't work. You know, and then we got to do it. I remember back right after we moved into our house there on Circle Way Street, we probably within like 6 months to a year, we realized that there was a bit of a leak problem. And so I jumped right on it and I called the roofer because in my mind, you know, with a relatively flat roof, if there is a problem, it probably means that there is a problem in the roof. Makes sense, doesn't it? Well, so I called the roofer. The roofer doesn't really want to come out, quite frankly. And I'm going, oh man. And so we kind of let it go. And then we call some air conditioning people and I talk to them and they say, because I'm thinking maybe the problem is also the air conditioner. The air conditioning people said, oh, no, no, the problem's the roof. It's got to be the roof. Okay. So we finally get the roofer to come out, and the roofer looks at it and goes, your roof is just fine. There's no problem with your roof. The problem has to be with the vent work in your air conditioning system. Oh, okay, what are we going to do? So we keep kind of going back and forth on all of this. And, you know, the leak isn't really getting horrible. We have a pan on the floor, and we decide not to use the light in the hallway because it's coming down through the light fixture. You know, probably wisdom is, you know, that's a better part of wisdom there. And so one day, it's like midnight, I'm walking to the bathroom to finish getting ready to go to sleep, to brush my teeth, and as I'm walking along, didn't touch the wall, didn't do anything, the ceiling fell in on top of my head. And it wasn't just a little piece, it was like a whole piece. Mike has seen my hallway, and it's the whole hallway ceiling just decides to come tumbling. Not the thing you want to take care of about midnight. So I decide to keep working on it. I got to get this solved because, you know, not only was there a mess, but there was a lot of water. So I start looking and I start looking and I finally get the air conditioning people out and they're going, ah, the vent work doesn't look good, but you know what? I'm going to tell you, the problem's the roof. The roofing people said, no, the problem's the vent work. I finally got a contractor who got down to the middle of it all and he said, I'll tell you what, the problem is actually both. It was both. I won't go into all the detail, but you know, the solution, once we figured it out, there was an answer. There was one solution. It was very practical. It was very doable. It was better. Now, the whole situation was worse, but you know, it was doable. Now, there was some logic that was involved in that discussion, in that problem, in that trying to figure out what to do. And logic finally found a good answer, and it took more than one person to actually think about it, but eventually, you know, all of us together kind of figured this is the best way to take care of it, and it worked. But when we try to take that same kind of logic and apply it to faith matters, to spiritual matters, we find that it doesn't work exactly the same way. There are potentially lots of different ways that we can deal with the problems and troubles that come in our sinful human existence. And some of them may work for a while, but when it comes to faith, faith that clings to the reality that God loves us and forgives us, there is really only one way that we can have true strength, peace, and contentment as we face all of the troubles that plague us. Psalm 37 tells us, for instance, trust in the Lord and He will help you. Trust in the Lord. He helps. It's sad to say, though, that there are those who yearn for true comfort and hope, but they have never really truly known it because they believe that true comfort and hope is something that is going to come from their ability, their strength, their reason, their figuring it out. They don't know how much God longs to help them. The Bible even says that God weeps with them, that He grieves with them, that God wants to wrap His arms around them and give them the certainty of His presence and His strength and peace in the middle of all of this trouble that is caused by sin in the world. He wants them to have lives with confidence and courage in his presence, in spite of the seeming hopelessness around them. Today, in our Old Testament reading, we hear God speaking to his people through the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah has been taken captive into a strange land, into Babylon. They were taken in chains into Babylon. They got to Babylon and they had a fairly good life, but they knew why they were there. They knew their guilt. They knew that they had not followed God's ways. And in fact, not only had they turned their back on what God wanted, they also went and did the most exorbitantly evil and sinful things that they possibly could. And now that they are afraid and they have little hope in their future. But in the middle chapters of the book of Isaiah, there is this powerful theme of hope. God is able to deliver his people, even people who struggle with sin. He is able to deliver his people, even people who have lived in uproariously evil ways before. He is able to deliver his people, not because they deserve it, but because he has given them a promise and he has loved them. Even when they think that he has given up on them, he has been with his people all along. And now he speaks to them these words of hope and encouragement. Listen to these words from God and hear him speak not only to Israel, but also to you. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. You are precious in my sight. I love you. Do not fear, for I am with you. And he goes on to emphasize that these are, using his words, my people. I created them. I will bring them home. You are precious to me, he says. I love you. Don't you just love these words from God's own mouth? They were spoken to people some thousands of years ago, but they might as well have been spoken to you and me right here today. God knew the despair of the people back then, but he also knows that because of sin in the world, what troubles we face today, and he speaks to us right now. Do not be afraid. I have called you by name. You are mine. As people who live in this world full of sin, we know that there is strife and there is turmoil, not only out there in the world, but also in our own lives, in our own families, in our own communities, even sometimes even in our own congregations, that there are people who struggle, people who have worries, people who struggle with sin, people who don't know what the right answers are. You know, we are people who by our very nature are sinful and unclean, so it wouldn't surprise us, it shouldn't surprise us that there is trouble. You know, it is easy for us to be selfish and unkind and to justify our wrongdoing. And we worry sometimes about things that are happening to our families. Now, I think there's legitimate concern, but you know, sometimes as human beings, we fall into this problem of making everything a catastrophe. You know, being half glass half empty people, not glass half full people. You can tell which one I am because I can't even say it. And sometimes we worry about our families and worry about our health and worry about our finances, worry about our work or worry about the lack of it. We stress about decisions that we need to make and what the future holds for us. I'm going to tell you that as a pastor, the coronavirus time has provided an extra amount of stress. Partly because there are so many people with so many different attitudes and so many different ideas, and we want to be able to listen to everyone, but not everyone is going to necessarily have the same idea. And coming to a meeting of the minds about even how we as a congregation move forward is sometimes a struggle. That's one of the reasons why over the next few weeks you're going to be hearing about an emphasis called revitality that the Synod has going, that we're going to be taking part in. It's a way of helping us to refocus our attention. It's not that we're doing a bad job. I'm going to tell you, St. Mark does a good job, so just to let you know. But could we actually re-examine who we are, who our community is, and how we do things? Yeah, certainly. And we're going to take advantage of that. These are legitimate things to be concerned about. On the other hand, there are also things that I don't want us to feel like they're catastrophes, because in the middle of a lot of things that have happened that we really didn't want to have happen, things that are bad, there is also some very good that has been going on. The other day I was talking to someone who was telling me, and he's one of these people who, if you can point out something about the coronavirus days that's bad, he'll tell you just like that. He has a list of like 40 things. But you know one of the things that he told me? He said, I'll tell you one good thing that came out of that is that with digital technology, I now no longer have to go into stores and they'll bring it to my house. Well, and I told him, I said, well, you know, they did that before the coronavirus. And he just kind of went, arr. You know, there are a lot of problems in the world, aren't there? And all of them, especially sin, can become our own Babylonian captivity. And we can all feel overwhelmed and overcome to the point of feeling powerless. You heard those words about being in the river and having water flow over us and feel like maybe we're drowning, or being in the middle of a fire. We know what that's like. We know what the experience is like to not have all of the answers, to be able to solve all of the problems, especially that problem with sin and our failing. But it's when we have this feeling of drowning or sinking or crashing under the weight of it all that God's words in Isaiah speak to us. When you pass through deep waters, I will be with you. The hard trials to come will not hurt you. Do not be afraid. I am with you. So today in our gospel reading, we hear about Jesus' baptism. As Jesus comes up out of the water, the Holy Spirit appears in the form of a dove, and a voice speaks from heaven, "You are my beloved Son, I am pleased with you." Jesus is just about to begin this mission, beginning with the temptation by Satan in the wilderness. You know what happens when he leaves the water? You know, we often think he leaves the water and maybe has a baptismal party. When I lived in Louisiana, every time there was a baptism, there was a party. And people actually kind of thought that Jesus did the same thing. I'm joking just a little bit, but not really. The fact is that Jesus comes up out of the water, he goes into the wilderness, and he is tempted and he is tried for 3 days. Boy, those words, "You are my beloved Son, I am pleased with you," are ones that I'm sure stuck with him all that time. And then throughout the 3 years of ministry, he struggles with people who he wants to hear the good word. That then he goes to the cross, and there is suffering, and there is death, and there is pain. Those words from the Father at Jesus' baptism are something like the words God spoke to his people in Isaiah. "You are my own dear Son. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you go through deep waters and great trouble, I will be with you. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. Do not be afraid, for I am with you." And God the Father was with God the Son at every single moment. In our baptism, God has washed us clean. God the Father has connected us through the work of the Holy Spirit to all that Jesus did on the cross for us, dying for us, taking on himself all of our sin. He endured the pain and suffering that should be ours, and then rising to life to ensure that we also will have a new life of forgiveness and wholeness forever and ever. Romans chapter 6, worth studying, worth looking at. That is the byproduct of baptism for us. In the water of baptism, God is our Savior, and he makes a promise to us. He says to each of us, "You have nothing to fear. I save you. I know each of you by name." That's an amazing thing, isn't it? He knows me. He knows you. He knows everything about you. And a lot of times people will go, "Oh no, he knows about me." And I'm going, no, that's a good thing. Because he knows where you struggle and he knows the help you need. And he is there with it. You are precious. I created and saved you. Do not be afraid. That is a wonderful message that we celebrate, don't we? But it's also a message that the world needs to hear. Because the world around us is in hopelessness and despair. If we think about the way that we struggle with hopelessness, even as Christians, and sometimes we despair, even as Christians, can you imagine what it would be like to have no hope in Christ Jesus at all? Some people don't even have a clue of the strength and comfort that is there for them in that promise of Jesus. And the hope that we have in Jesus Christ is something that not only can we share, but we can actually deliver. You know, sharing is one of those odd ideas that somehow means I'm going to only give you a little bit of what I have. But actually, we do more than share the gospel, that we give people the whole truth in Christ Jesus. The last verse in the Old Testament reading goes like this: "They are my own people, and I created them to bring me glory." I created them to bring me glory. Now, it is true that we do proclaim glory here in church. We sing praises and we say, "God, you are glorious, you are glorious. But you know, when we talk about glory and we talk about praise, it's really not something that in the Old Testament concept is that we do just inside the building of the church or we do in our own devotions. You know, praising God and giving him glory means that we go out into the streets, go out among our friends and family, and however is the best way to do it with people as individuals, that we give God the glory. You know, I have to actually give it to those athletes who stand up in network TV and they talk about something that happened and that they say, and God did it. To God be the glory. Now, some, I kind of get the sense, maybe they're just saying it because that's what you say. But others, when you hear the story and you hear what's going on, you're going, amen. You know, I'm not sure how many of us have ever done that. Not that we get on network TV and do that, but have we ever stood up and talked to our friends or family and told them? You know, it's not like every time we talk to someone, we've got to go through the whole plan of salvation and convert them just like that. That's not going to work. In fact, it's going to probably take time. It's going to take patience. It's going to take prayer. But it is something that we have that is a precious gift that we want others to have completely. And that we do share it with patience and gentleness and wisdom. And sometimes it even means some straight talk to people. You know, where we let them know, hey, you know, I'm concerned about you, and here's why. We need to do something. Really, it's not a logical choice. It's something that we do, that we share the good news of Jesus with the people around us. Now, sometimes we have this idea that that means that we go out and we go to a mission field, you know, someplace like my friends in Uganda or in South Africa or in some other place like Venezuela. You know, that's not what I'm talking about. It can be someone next door. It can be your brother, your sister, your child. It can be someone who even already knows about Jesus but just is struggling. Oh my goodness, how many people do we know who know Jesus, but they are struggling right now because they're afraid? And really what they need to hear is that in the middle of all of that struggle, in the middle of all of that sin, in the middle of all of that chaos, in the middle of all of that trouble, God is there for you in Jesus Christ. So here we are. We're right here at the beginning of 2022. Boy, that's actually kind of difficult to say, isn't it? 2022. And this Isaiah passage provides us with a good start for the year. This word of God for today reminds us that whatever the future may hold for us in this year, we have the promise that our Savior made to us in our baptism. It's the same firm promise spoken to God's people over the centuries. They are words that encourage and give confidence in the future. Do not be afraid, God says. I will save you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the deep waters, I will be with you. Your troubles will not overwhelm you, whatever those troubles may be. COVID? Finances? Employment issues? Family conflict? Your own hidden sins? Your own fears? I will be with you. When you pass through the fire, you will not be burned. The hard trials that come will not hurt you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy God of Israel, who saves you. Do not be afraid. Now may the peace that passes all our human understanding, may it keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Please rise. Heavenly Father, you have fulfilled all righteousness in the baptism of your beloved Son. As we have received this righteousness by our baptism into him, make us bold in faith and fervent love, that we may live out heavenly lives here in this world. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, as you have opened heaven to your church through holy baptism, give her faithful teachers to proclaim your Son, Jesus Christ, and all that accords with godliness, that many would repent of their sins and join him in the heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Preserve the family, O God, especially all Christian homes. Turn husbands and wives toward one another in love. Equip fathers and mothers for the holy duty as teachers of the faith. And preserve all children in the saving faith and certain promises of their baptism into everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Almighty Father, you break the wicked with your rod for the sake of your beloved children. Help us at all times to serve you with fear and seek refuge always in the kingdom of your Son. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. Heavenly Father, your Son Jesus is the true Christ and the true King of this world. Grant great humility to the rulers of nations, that they would submit to the preaching of your holy word for the sake of their souls and for the good of your holy people. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. O Lord, you sent your Son to serve your people and deliver them from sin and death. Because we long for your salvation, bring us out of our afflictions and uphold all those bruised in spirit. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you manifested yourself with the Holy Spirit in the fullness of grace at the baptism of your dear Son. With your voice, you directed us to the one who has borne our sins, that we may receive grace and forgiveness. Keep us, we implore you, in the true faith, since we have been baptized in accord with your command and the example of your Son. Strengthen our faith by your Holy Spirit and lead us to everlasting life and salvation. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. It's great to have all of you worshiping with us today. Just a reminder that next Sunday, Pastor Adam still resumes the Galatians Bible study in Luke. And also, we have a new Bible study and time beginning called the Salvation Cafe, and that will be in the Fellowship Hall starting at 9:15. There'll be continental breakfast, and it's available to anyone. So please join us again for the Salvation Cafe next Sunday at 9:15. The Adult Inquirers class continues on Wednesday at 7 p.m. In the room Luke. There will be a Bible study on Thursday at 9 a.m. also in Luke. Youth Confirmation class resumes this week at 6:30 p.m. on Thursday in Luke. And finally, we want to thank all those that participated yesterday in removal of the greens and getting the church reset back after Christmas. Speaking of Christmas, poinsettias that have been purchased are still available in the back of the narthex. There's a clipboard. If you purchase one, please scratch your name off and take your flowers with you. Those are all the announcements. So have a great Sunday and look forward to seeing you again.